Dear learners, welcome in the world of Python programming under machine learning using Python series of lectures. This is lecture 5, more on Python loops. So we'll study more on the loops used in Python. Hi, I'm Dr. Sunil from GCS Solutions. So contents of this lecture are, we'll learn range and loops. We'll again see the use of loops with different test conditions. We'll see how to use nested loops, and we'll also see the pattern printing in the Python. A range function can be used with loops, and that's why I had taken range along with the loop concept, because there is some relevancy between range and loops. So here we'll be using range with for loop more particularly. And we need to use this range function with loops to solve more complex problems in very simple way. How? So we'll see two programs here which will give us idea how to solve complex problem by using just one or two lines of code using for and range. So here I have first problem, print sum of all odd or even numbers from 1 to 10. Means whatever logic I will apply for odd, a small change in that logic will give me a solution to print even numbers from 1 to 10. So that we'll see. And the second problem statement is, print every fourth number of all numbers from 1 to 15. Like suppose I am at 1, I will go to 1, 2, 3 and 4. If I am at 4, I will go to 4, 5, 6 and 7. So this way I want jump and want to print all the numbers from 1 to 15. Now let us see the logic behind this. So I have this code snippet. So in this code snippet, initially I take a variable sum which will hold the sum of the numbers from 1 to 10. So that sum will be the sum of all odd numbers from 1 to 10. Now here I have only 3 line of code, rather 4 lines. So here I have a loop for num in range 1, 11, 2. I say sum equal to sum plus num. Once I finish up with this execution of for loop, I print the sum and I get some output. Here the value is 25. Now, what does this code do in background? Now, let us try to understand. When I say sum equal to 0, a variable sum will be assigned a value 0. Now, this range function has 3 arguments. The first argument is a start value, the second argument is stop value, and the third argument is a step value. So, this will result in creation of list internally in the Python. Now, Python will create a list with the help of range function. So it will start with 1, and as you know that Python will always take a range till what? Stop value minus 1. So here in our case stop value is 11, so it will be ranging from 1 to 10. But along with this specification, we have also added one more thing, that is value 2 as the step value. So it will start with 1, it will add 1 in 2, it will take next value as 3, so here is the representation. So num in, so it takes first 1, adds 2, then because step value is 2, so it takes 3, plus 2, it takes 5, plus 2, it takes 7, plus 2, it takes 9, but it has a restriction up to 10. So it won't be taking 9 plus 2, 11. Now here, we'll now see how this sum equal to sum plus num will get evaluated. So here num is taking values range from 1 to 9. So initially num will be given value 1. So we have for each num value, this sum equal to sum plus num statement is to be executed. So here new value of sum is equal to old value. So initially sum is 0, here num is 1. So 0 plus 1 will be 1. So the new value of sum will be 1, which will be remembered for the next iteration. So when num is 3, Your sum is old value of sum, which is 1, which is the value taken from the earlier iteration, and it will add 3, that becomes 4. Similarly, when num is 5, so new sum equal to old sum, which is 4, plus new sum, new num value 5, it becomes 9. And for num 7, it is 9 plus 7. And for num equal to 9, sum is equal to 16 plus 9, that is 25. So we have got 25 as the output. If you run this code snippet, you will get the same answer. So this way it works. So what do we understand from this? That to do programs like this, it is very easy to use for and range. For and range will simplify your programming logic. Now here, we'll see one more problem statement. Print every fourth number of all the numbers from 1 to 5. So what does it mean that we want to print every fourth number? Suppose I am at 1, I will jump to 1, 2, 3 and 4. Suppose I am at 4, I will say 4, because 4 is my current position, that will be counted 4, 5, 6, 7. So this way, I have just two lines of code for num in range 1. So I have started with value 1. Stop value is 16, that is 16 minus 1, 15, and step is 3. So that will give me jump at exactly fourth location from the current location. So this way, automatically a list will be created in background for this range 1, 16, 3. So what is that? It is 1, 4, 7, 10 and 13. Now each time num is taking value from 1 till the last value 13. And it prints that value. So 1, 4, 7, 10 and 13. So if you see this, it is very easy to solve complex problems like this using very simplified way. Now here we'll see various test conditions used in loop. Now let us see number logic. So any number which is other than 0 is always true. What does it mean? Number other than 0 is always true. In other way, I may say if number is 0, then numerically that number has Boolean value false or 0. If number is other than 0, then that particular number has a Boolean value true. Basically, Python interprets numbers in this way. For example, I have 10. So what does this 10 mean? 10 means this is the number other than 0. So it is positive number. Minus 45, this is the number other than 0. 5.6, this is the real number other than 0. What is this 5 plus 7j? It is again a number other than 0. So all these numbers will be interpreted internally by Python as a Boolean numbers and value will be true. If I treat this number as Boolean numbers, then value is true, which is internally 1. But if I have 0, which is again a number, but it is 0. 0.0, again a number which is equal to 0. And 0 plus 0j is a complex 0. And all these numbers will be internally treated as a Boolean. If Boolean, then that is false. That means 0 value. Now, if I use this for the purpose of decision making in loops, or rather test condition in the loop, then it has a bit different interpretation that we are going to see. For example, if I say what is bool of 0, so bool is the function which returns the value of the, that is the either true or value of the argument passed. So if for boolean I have passed 0, it returns me false because 0 is always false. If I say 0.000, it is again a 0, it returns me false. Now if I say bool 0 plus 0j, because this is the complex number having value 0, so it also interpreted as a false. But what if I say bool of 12? So it returns me true. That means a number 12, when treated as a Boolean value, it is true. What if I have some long number, negative number, that is minus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? If I ask now bool function, what is this value? It says it is true, because this value, when treated as a Boolean value, it is interpreted as a true value. So it returns me true. Similarly, I have a 2 plus 0j. So here, real is 2 and imaginary is 0. Though imaginary is 0, real part is non-zero value. So this whole number will be a non-zero number, and that is true. So this way this number logic works in Python. Now this number logic will play a very vital role while executing the loops. For example, if I say while 0, I have this code snippet. You may run this code by typing this in some editor and then execute that code either on the Python prompt, or you may use some smart editor like Spider, Jupyter Notebook or PyCharm or any other like Eclipse. Now here I have these four lines of statement, print out outside while. Now here is the while loop, but in while loop I have specified 0 as the value. But you know well, if any number which is other than 0 is true, if it is 0 it is false. And I have one printf statement associated with this while, which will be strictly printed when while condition is true. So I print here not getting into the loop. And after that I have again a statement which is independent of this while, which prints after a loop. Now if I try to execute this code, I get output like outside while and after loop. Now this not getting in loop, which is the statement to be printed based on the trueness of the while condition, will not get executed at all, because while 0 is always false. So this test condition is false. So as while is false, Python will not get into the while loop. So this statement will not get executed. Now let us see with the non-zero value. So here again I have the same way of coding. So here I have one more statement here, break statement. We'll see why do I use break. So here I have one statement outside the while and the other one after the while. So in while I have two statements, print getting into loop and break. But here the test condition in while is negative number. As we saw that any number other than 0 is always true. Now this is true. Immediately after this it will get into this block, while block, and it will print getting into the loop. But I have applied here break. Why? Because if some condition is true and if that condition is not updated, it will be something different. We'll see what that different thing is. So it gets out of the loop immediately after printing this getting into loop, and we'll say after loop. So these three statements will get executed. Now we'll see the logic behind using this break statement. So let us come to this fourth rectangle code snippet which is represented in fourth rectangle of this slide. So here I have some group of statements. So here in this particular loop I have while true. Now you know well, true internally is 1 and 1 is non-zero value. So this will be the loop with condition true, and it will get executed for sure. Now if I say while true and just print getting into loop, you will be landing in some trouble. What is that trouble? You will be getting printed this thing outside while getting into loop, and this is called infinite loop. Why? Because this loop has a test condition which is always resulting in the true. There is no condition which is updating this test condition and which will make that test condition false and will bring that control out of the loop. So this is a thing at which you have to be cautious. So be cautious. This is infinite loop. So this sort of programming logic will land you in trouble. Now here we'll see nesting of the loops. Now question is, why do we need nesting of loops? We have already seen nesting of the statements like if, if else, elif. Now why do we need this nesting of loop? We need nesting of loop for again some complex logical interpretation of programs in Python. Because programming is not so simple like hello friends, hi, 10 plus 20 is how much, or what is the bool of 5 plus 7j. This is not the programming. These are the concepts which are to be understood. But actual programming may have some complex requirements to be done using Python program. So in that case, we need this nesting of loops. More specifically, if you are dealing with matrices, that time you need this nesting of loops. Now let us see the matrix interpretation. Suppose I want to interpret matrix and I want to represent that interpretation using a simple program in Python. So I have just a 4 lines of code here. Now if you see here, so I have for row in range 1 to 5, I print nothing. That means I go to a line and print nothing. After that I have a inner loop. So this is the outer loop, which is the row loop, and this is the inner loop, which is the column loop. So I have this row loop ranging from 1 to 5. So 5 is exclusive, so it will take value from 1 to 4. And here the inner loop, which is again a part of this outer block, has a 2 statements, print and for column in range 1 to 4. So what this column value will be? It will be ranging from 1 to 3, not 4, because 4 is the stop. So list will be always, range will be always from 1 to 3. So here I am trying to print pair of row column. Now what is the interpretation of this 4 lines of code? Do remember, when there is nesting of the loops, your inner loop will be executed repeatedly for each outer value of loop counter variable. That means for each value of row, this whole column range will be executed. Now I have represent this internal interpretation and the execution in this rightmost rectangle. Now row in 1, 2, 3, 4, because we have a range for row from 1 to 5, that is 5 exclusive. Now for each row value, there will be execution, complete execution of column for loop. So column will be taking value 1, 2, 3 each time. So when row is 1, column is taking value 1, 2, 3. When row is 2, column is taking value 1, 2, 3 again. When row is 3, column is taking again 1, 2, 3. And when row is 4, column is again taking value, that is 1 to 4. So this way it will be interpreted. Now if you see this, it is just like a row column representation, interpretation. That means for each outer value of for, that is row, column is getting repeated. It is just like first row, first column, first row, second column, first row, third column. So for row 2, it is again row 2, column 1, row 2, column 2, row 2, column 3. It is, when row is 3, it is row 3, column 1, row 3, column 2, row 3, column 3. So this way, if you see the output, actual output, which is in first rectangle, so you will say 1, 1, that is first row, first column, first row, second column, first row, third column. So second row, first column, second row, second column, second row, third column. So this way, I have 4 rows and 3 columns. Hope so you understood this. Now let us try with these patterns. It's fun for you to do, because once you understood loops, you can play with the patterns like this. Perhaps you might have done this thing in some programs or in some programming language, perhaps C, C++, Java, if you are C, C++, Java programmers. Now here we'll be dealing with the patterns. We'll try how this pattern problem is interpreted. Now if you see this pattern, so and just view this pattern as a lines printed one after another, then there is no clue of how to do programming for this. But if you are a smart programmer, then you will not view this as a line of text or line of stars. You will view this as a row column pattern. Now if you see that on first line there is one star, on second line there are two stars, on third line there are three stars, on the fourth line there are four stars, and on fifth line there are five stars. Now there are five lines. That means mathematically I have five rows. So I have represented in the diagram below. So I have five rows, and I have same number of columns, that is 5 columns. Now if you see carefully, for row 1 I am just taking column 1 and skipping all the remaining columns, because each row, even though has 5 columns, but for row 1 I am taking column 1, for row 2 I am taking 2 columns. So this shows me that if my row value is 2, I am restricting my column value to that row value. That means if my row value is 2, I am just restricting myself to occupy only 2 columns. So column value is restricted to row value. If my row value is 3, I am just occupying 4 columns. So that means column value is again restricted to row value. If my row value is 4, I am again restricting my column to row. That means only those many rows, only those many columns which are equal to the value of row. So this interpretation will help me in formulating the program logic. So it is just the row column interpretation which we have learned in earlier slide. Now let us see this code. This is very simple. So I want 5 rows and 5 columns. So what I do now here? I do one thing. I say, so I have loops within loops. So outer loop is for row, so that will count number of rows, and inner loop is for column, so that will count number of columns. So if I say for row in range 1 to 6, so here will be the internal happenings in the Python, that row in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So because we have start value as 1 and we have stop value 6, so it will be 1 to 5. So we are getting 5 row values. And for column, we have restricted our range to row. That means I have to take only those many rows which are equal to the, I have to take only those many columns which are equal to the row value. So I have to restrict my column to row. So it is very simple, for column in range row. Now let us see this interpretation, internal interpretation, in the third rectangle here in this slide. So for each value of row, for example, if row is 1, my column is getting restricted to 0. Why? Because if I don't specify start value, range function always starts with 0. So if I say 1, so it will take only 0, only 1 range, one value in the range. When row is 2, so it takes 0 and 1. When row value is 3, so it is something like range 3. Now how far that range goes? If range specification is 3, it will be 0, 1 and 2. So here it is 0, 1 and 2. When it is 4, it is 0, 1, 2 and 3. So I have shown here that when row is 1, column is taking 0, and that column loop will get executed how many times? Only 1 times, because it is taking only 1 value. So 1 star will get printed. When row is 2, column is taking how many values? 1 and 0 and 1. So it is getting how many times executed? 2 times. So it is printing 2 star. So how do I do that? So I use here print statement, to which I have passed 2 arguments. First one is star and the second one is the end character I want. So this end is the attribute which tells print statement that what should be the separator among different printed values on the same line. So this will also tell interpreter, that is Python, that all values should be printed on the same line and there should be a space as a separator. So here these 2 arguments will help Python to interpret printing star on the same line separated by spaces. So I put here comment hash print star, and after printing each column we are going to the new line and then we go for the next row value. So this way these stars are printed. So here for row 1, so only 1 value. For row 2, 2 column values it will take, 2 stars will be printed. For row 3, it will iterate for 3 times and 3 star will get printed. For row 4, column will get iterated to 4 times and 4 star will get printed, so and so forth. So this way you can even make this program more generalized. You can even ask that how many lines you want a pattern to get printed. So if I say 7, so it will be something like on first line it will be 1 star and on the last line there will be 7 stars. So I suggest you to go for this pattern printing program. Now what of number printing? So it is same thing. So instead of stars, I view this pattern as a number pattern. So instead of printing one star on row 1, column 1 for row 1 and two star on row 2, I print number. The numbers are varied depending on the row. For example, on row 2, I have 1 and 2. On row 3, I have 1, 2, 3. So instead of star, I have same way of doing the things. Instead of printing star, so see here in the second rectangle of my slide. Here instead of printing star, I say column plus 1. Why I say column plus 1? So let us see here in the third rectangle. Here, when my row value is 1, column is 0. And I want to print column value, but what I want to get printed, not 0. On first row, there should be numeric value 1. So I say column plus 1. When column value is 0, 0 plus 1 is 1. So on first row, there will be 1 value printed, that is numeric value 1. When row is 2, column will be varying from 0 to 1. So when column is 0, I say 0 plus 1, 1. And when column is 1, I say 1 plus 1, 2. So what will get printed on the new line? It will be 1 and 2 on the second row. Similarly, on the third row, column will take 3 values. So I say column plus 1. So it will be 0 plus 1, 1, 1 plus 1, 2, and 2 plus 1, 3. So these way it will print 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for the last row. Hope so that you have understood this. So these way you have to interpret the things and you have to do the programming. So programming is basically thinking, not coding. Typing is coding and coding is typing. But what is programming? Programming is planning and thinking. Once you understand the syntax and semantics of any specific language, you need to work on algorithms. You need to work on building logic. And then you may call yourself proudly as a true computer or IT professional. So this way we have done with the all basics of the loop. So dear learners, how was my lecture? Please let me know if you like this. If you like my lecture, please like, share among your friends. If you are not yet subscribed to my channel, please subscribe. So we are GCS Solutions, making technology easy to learn. Be with us. Till next lecture, happy coding.